Excuse me, Mr. Culhane, I think he left these in our department.
Well, thank you, Robin.
You're welcome.
In Tron, the Disney studio took you to a world inside a computer. This year, they're designing a brontosaurus from a prehistoric world for a picture called Baby. Two worlds no human being has ever seen before, 60 million years apart. You're talking a lot of research. And yet, in a mere 2 or 3 years, that young man over there with a sculptor has helped supervise the technical effects for both projects. Of course, his credentials are a bit out of the ordinary.
Hi, I'm John Sheely. Dinosaurs have always been a special love of mine, which is only natural since my dad was the director for some 30 years of the Cleveland Museum of Natural Sciences. In fact, I went out on my first dinosaur dig at age 3. At Harvard, when I was an undergraduate, I studied paleontology as well as filmmaking. But little did I imagine at that time that I'd be here at the Disney Studios today working on a project, Baby, that would allow me to bring both those interests to bear. It's not the first time Disney has made a dinosaur movie, of course. Their Rites of Spring sequence in Fantasia is famous. The people at the Smithsonian request it whenever they do a symposium on how dinosaurs moved and behaved. Since that time, there have been a lot of amazing discoveries made about dinosaurs, and we're trying to incorporate in Jim's sculpture here in this movie as much of that as possible. The premise of the movie bases itself on the recurring rumor that there are still today brontosauruses living deep somewhere in the Congo. In fact, Caltech sent an expedition out there as recently as this past September in the hopes of finding one. None found yet, but that's what we base our movie on, that a couple of paleontologists, a young couple, go out in the jungle and find this baby, and a number of adventures ensue, which you will see as the movie comes to your local theaters. The research we've been doing in the last weeks at this stage, we're building these clay models, studying the structure of the heads, among other things. The brontosaurus was portrayed for a long time with the wrong type of head. When the first key specimen was found, there have only been two brontosaurus skulls ever discovered. It was reconstructed with the wrong skull. So we've been trying to incorporate the proper look in the head, the posture. The tail is up in the air as it really would have been in life. The tail on this animal served the function of counterbalancing its long neck and head. It acted much like a suspension bridge does to counterbalance weight. So our problem has been to create here in clay first a model of what the dinosaur is going to look like, what our baby will look like, and then be prepared to scale that up and translate it into a miniature for motion control effects and a large-scale prop in which a human being can operate the legs and the hind and fore legs and move the dinosaur about. And over here, Ron Tanton and Isidore are working on the mechanical model.
What we try to do is to bring in life the baby dinosaur. This lever with this box represent the dinosaur brain. At this cable, they represent the nervous system, and they are connect to the muscle system where is a representative from this mechanical part. And this piece here is the undercover. When all this mechanism is covered with this rubber, go down, it will be a very good movement with no wrinkle. The function of the man inside is to bring this mechanical dinosaur walking around to make him very believable. To make the man more comfortable to walking, we extend his arm with a mechanical arm.
This looks real good, Izzy. Let's see if we can throw it on film and see what it will do. What we did to start with is base our concept with an actual dinosaur skeleton of a brontosaurus. And we took the skeleton and compressed it to a size of what our concept of a baby dinosaur would be. Phil, why don't you move back and forth and you guys try to keep it going. Okay, back a little. And once we get the muscles over this mechanism and the skin on top of the muscles, we hope to have at the end product a very realistic and very cuddly looking baby dinosaur.
I've been asked to look at a few old film clips. It'll only take a couple of minutes. Why don't you join me? Okay, roll it, please.
Hello, como vai?
Mr. Bluebird's on my shoulder. It's the truth. It's actual. Everything is satisfactual. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay. Wonderful feeling, wonderful day.
Wait up. Wait up.
Now then, what would be nice? We'll start with raspberry ice. And
do you remember all those? The last one is easy. Mary Poppins. The middle one is Song of the South. And the first one? The Three Caballeros. I'm sure you noticed that all three of those shows had one thing in common. They all combined animated cartoon characters with live-action real people, which is not all that easy to do. But this bunch in here intends to use that technique as it's never been used before, to tell a full-length feature story. I love the title. Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Come on. Mark? Well, never mind. We'll come back later.
Tell them something about the picture, but I thought, you know, before they get here, we ought to try to figure out what it is we want to tell them.
Yeah.
I thought we could start by introducing ourselves. You know, I'd say this is Darrell Van Citters, the animation director. Mike Giamo, the character designer and story man. And I'm Mark Sturtevant, the producer.
Very good, Mark.
You like that?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see if I can go on. First, the premise, I suppose, basically to tell them that Roger Rabbit is a live-action picture in which half the cast is made up of animated characters. It's based on the premise that cartoon characters really live. They're not drawn, but they exist in this world just like human beings do. Our hero, that's Roger Rabbit, your basic 6-foot animated rabbit. He's a second banana on a cartoon series known as the Baby Herman cartoons. And Roger is a lovable, naive, sincere, and kind of goofy type of guy who is always trying to do the right thing, but always manages to mess things up. In our story, which takes place in Hollywood in the 1940s, Roger's framed for the murder of a Hollywood producer. And he hires a live-action private detective, a sort of seedy, cynical, Humphrey Bogart kind of guy, to clear his name. Then in the course of the story, they come across a number of possible suspects. Among them is Jessica Rabbit, Roger's wife. Now, Jessica is a rabbit by marriage only. She's actually an ambitious young starlet who married Roger to further her career. And now that she's been given a part in a film that she wanted, she's cast Roger aside. She doesn't care for him anymore. Roger can't see this. He's blindly in love with her, and he just doesn't see Jessica for the cunning and seductive person that she really is. Then I guess there's Captain Cleaver. Cleaver is the tough cop from downtown. He's the head of the homicide division, and he's a big, brash, pushy, cigar-smoking police captain.
Oh, Cleaver, sorry, I didn't see you. What's on your mind?
Get off the Roger Rabbit case. I got the wife pegged as the killer, and I'm an inch away from proving it. You keep poking around, you're liable to screw up my play, and that would make me very unhappy.
Why don't I show him a little bit of the technical side of it? We could show John just what we need when we get it to the animation stage. Just a little bit, not a, you know, we don't want to bore him or anything.
Yeah.
Just a little bit of how we fit the cartoon characters into the live action.
Sure.
For example, well, we could put down the, I could show him what we do in the production, how we'll shoot it on the stage, and there'll be a big empty spot there in the composition, so it looks like a very bad composition. But we leave that space, so we have a place to put the animated character in later.
Yeah.
And so if the animator can animate to that, then we'll take each frame and blow it up to a photostat size so that the animator knows what he's doing. And then he'll put that photostat down on his pegs and put down the paper and get to drawing it.
Now comes the hard part.
Yes.
Now, what we've seen on this scene looks pretty good. The interaction between the live and the animated really comes off well.
Yeah, particularly the way she interacts with Eddie at this point.
Yeah.
She moves in and around him, and there's a lot of contact.
Yeah, that's going to be difficult. You know, most animated live pictures that combine the mediums have stayed away from that, and we're
going
to haul off and try to really put together a lot of contact between the live and the animated characters. That's pretty good.
Well, perhaps after that I could show him a stack of animation, show him the rough drawings so they can get an idea of what it looks like before it gets into the final production.
Mm-hmm.
Flip through it, show Jessica's action.
Yeah,
that looks good.
Of course, Eddie's not in it now, but he will be in the final when we composite it.
You know, that's a thought. Maybe we ought to show him the composite test, the pencil test, which has the live action and the animation together.
Mr. Valiant, you have beautiful features. So strong and well-defined.
Chipped out of granite, that's me.
You will take my case, won't you?
Not a chance.
What do you mean, not a chance?
Yeah, I think that'd be good. John would like to see that for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that'll explain the whole process, too.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm hungry. How about it?
Yeah, let's go to lunch.
Who's buying?
Hey, not me.
Hey, where do you guys want to eat?
Anywhere but the commissary.
As long as Darrell's treating, I don't care.
Some imagination these guys have here at Disney. Can you believe it? Cartoon characters walking around with real people?
You're probably beginning to